that. The lower pole of the kidney represents a relatively unique anatomic location in the kidney in terms of stone management, and that's an observation that's based primarily on the finding that the results of shockwave lithotripsy vary according to the location in the kidney, and the lower pole of the kidney seems to have a particular impact on stone-free rates. So if we look at series in the literature, retrospective series, in which the outcomes for shockwave lithotripsy are stratified by stone location, we see that the highest stone-free rates are achieved for stones in the renal pelvis and the UPJ, followed by the upper pole, the mid pole, and then the lower pole. And those are the lowest stone-free rates that are achieved. And again, retrospectively, about 63% stone-free rates in series in the literature for stones in the lower pole of the kidney. But despite the fact that there's been relatively poor stone-free rates for lower pole stones, and this is thought to be primarily because the gravity-dependent location of the lower pole calyces that hinder the clearance of fragments from the lower pole, shockwave lithotripsy has still been frequently chosen as the procedure of choice for treatment of lower pole stones because it's non-invasive. It obviously has a high patient acceptance rate because of that. It has a relatively low complication rate, and failures with shockwave lithotripsy can be easily salvaged with either PCNL or with ureteroscopy. Now, recognizing that the clearance of fragments from the lower pole is sometimes poor, a number of investigators have proposed maneuvers to try to improve the clearance of fragments out of the lower pole. And that includes the use of controlled inversion therapy along with percussion and hydration, the use of vibration massage that's implemented immediately after shockwave lithotripsy, or the use of retrograde catheters such as Cobra catheters that are directed into the lower pole of the kidney to provide constant irrigation during shockwave lithotripsy to encourage the fragments to clear out of the lower pole, or the use of a nephrostomy tube for the same purpose, for continuous irrigation to encourage fragments to clear out of the lower pole. And one of the better studies that has looked at some of these maneuvers came from John Honey and Ken Pace in Toronto, who looked at this regimen of percussion inversion and diuresis therapy. And they took 69 patients who were left with less than 4 millimeter residual stones after shockwave lithotripsy at 3 months, and then randomized them to undergo this regimen of percussion inversion and diuresis therapy versus observation alone. And they found that those study patients cleared their fragments additionally in 40% of cases versus 3% for the control group. So this regimen did seem to improve the clearance of fragments that were left in the lower pole of the kidney, and they concluded this was a safe and effective treatment option to improve the clearance of these fragments. Now, these were patients who started with stones anywhere in the kidney but then ultimately were left with fragments sitting in the lower pole. Well, there was another randomized trial that was just recently reported last year that looked at 108 patients who started with lower pole stones, treated with shockwave lithotripsy, and then they were randomized immediately after treatment to undergo either this regimen of percussion inversion and diuresis therapy or no additional treatment, and then were followed for 3 months and re-imaged. And at that point, stone-free rates were determined and found to be only 35% in the control group who had no additional treatment after ESWOL, versus 63% for patients who underwent this treatment. So this suggests that if we initiate this kind of a regimen immediately after shockwave lithotripsy, we can expect higher stone-free rates than patients who are simply treated with no additional therapy. Now, other investigators have recommended pharmacologic therapy to try to improve the stone-free rates after shockwave lithotripsy, and there was a Turkish group who took 110 patients who had undergone shockwave lithotripsy for lower pole stones and then evaluated those patients 4 weeks after shockwave lithotripsy. And that group consisted of 56 patients who had been rendered stone-free and 34 patients who were left with less than 5 millimeter residual fragments. And these two groups were then both randomized to receive a regimen of potassium citrate therapy or to receive no additional drug therapy, and then all these patients were evaluated at a year with imaging studies. So if you look at the stone-free rate, the recurrence rate in the group of patients who were initially rendered stone-free, you see that those treated with potassium citrate therapy had no additional recurrence rates at a year, whereas those who were treated with no drug had a 28% recurrence rate. So potassium citrate was able to keep patients stone-free at a higher rate than those who were left with residual fragments. And moreover, if you look at those patients who were left with residual fragments And now you look at the resolution of those fragments over a course of a year. You find that those who were treated with potassium citrate therapy in 44.5% of cases additionally cleared those fragments at a year, whereas those treated with no drug cleared their fragments in only 12.5% of cases. So this suggests that, in fact, potassium citrate therapy may be able to actually promote the spontaneous passage of fragments that are left in the kidney after shockwave lithotripsy. So again, another maneuver to help improve the relatively poor overall stone-free rates that we see with shockwave lithotripsy for lower pole stones. Now, on the other hand, percutaneous treatment of lower pole stones is not dependent on location. Generally, you have high stone-free rates regardless of the location of the stone in the kidney. These tend to be fairly easy percs, and they're generally safe because you can access these the lower pole calyx generally below the 12th rib, so you avoid the risk of a hydrothorax, and it's generally a highly effective procedure. So if you look at the influence of stone size as well as stone location for PCNL, You see that stone-free rates tend to not be particularly affected by the size of the stone, and that relatively high stone-free rates are achieved independent of stone size. So Jim Lingemann was one of the early investigators to really recognize the problems or the limitations of shockwave lithotripsy for the treatment of lower pole stones, and to recognize the relative high success rates with PCNL. So he performed a meta-analysis of trials in the literature that had stratified lower pole data, looking at both outcomes for shockwave lithotripsy and PCNL. And this included 13 ESWOL studies and 3 PCNL studies with nearly 3,000 ESWOL patients and 101 PCNL cases, and found that the overall stone-free rates were 90% for PCNL versus only 60% for shockwave lithotripsy. And if you controlled for stone size, patients with lower pole stones were more than 6 times more likely to be rendered stone-free with PCNL compared with shockwave lithotripsy. So this was really the first time we had seen an actual sort of head-to-head comparison, although retrospectively, that showed the superiority of PCNL over shockwave lithotripsy. When you looked at that same data and then stratified the outcomes for both PCNL and shockwave lithotripsy by stone size, you see that for PCNL, the stone-free rates were uniformly high, regardless of stone size, similar to what we had seen in other retrospective series. On the other hand, for shockwave lithotripsy, acceptable stone-free rates were achieved really only for stones less than a centimeter in size, and in that case, a 74% stone-free rate was achieved. And that dropped off to only 56% for stones between 1 and 2 centimeters, and then only 33% for stones that were greater than 2 centimeters in size. So these investigators concluded that shockwave lithotripsy was reasonable only for stones less than a centimeter in size. So based on the findings from the meta-analysis, Jim Lingemann then initiated a prospective multi-institutional randomized trial, again comparing shockwave lithotripsy and PCNL for lower pole stones. And there were 14 institutions represented, and in all, 160 patients with lower pole stones were randomized to ESWOL or PCNL, and the randomization was stratified by stone size. Ultimately, 107 patients were available for 3-month follow-up, and that's what the outcomes are then based on. So the primary outcome parameter in this study was stone-free status determined by nephrotomograms, and it's important to keep that in mind because most of the retrospective series that have looked at stone-free rates have used KUBs for determining stone-free rates, and we know that nephrotomograms are going to be somewhat more sensitive for detecting residual stones, so we could expect that we'll probably see a drop in the stone-free rates just based on the type of imaging study used to determine stone-free status. And then secondary outcome parameters included hospital stay, complication rates, retreatment rates, and then overall quality of life issues. So we see from that study that just overall stone-free rates were significantly higher for PCNL than shockwave lithotripsy, 95% versus only 37%. Not surprisingly, the length of stay was significantly shorter for ESWOL compared to PCNL because most ESWOLs are performed on an outpatient basis, and the average length of stay was just over 2.5 days for PCNL. And complication rates were about twice as high for PCNL compared to shockwave lithotripsy, and as expected, those complications tend to be relatively minor for ESWOL and somewhat more significant for PCNL. However, the retreatment rate and the auxiliary procedure rate were both significantly higher for PCNL compared to ESWOL. Now, if we look at the results stratified by stone size, as we did in the meta-analysis, you see that once again, PCNL stone-free rates are quite high regardless of stone size, and we see just a very slight dependence on stone size with a slight drop-off on the stone-free rates as stones get bigger. But again, for shockwave lithotripsy, we see that for stones less than a centimeter, the stone-free rate of only 63% was achieved, and that was compared to 74% in the meta-analysis. And that dropped off significantly to only 23% for stones between 1 and 2 centimeters. And then a dismal 14% stone-free rate was achieved for stones greater than 2 centimeters. So these results are actually even significantly worse than what we saw in the meta-analysis, in part because of the use of nephrotomograms to determine outcomes as opposed to KUB, and partly as this is a prospective and randomized trial. So again, the investigators concluded that shockwave lithotripsy is reasonable only for relatively small stones. Now, if we take that same data and look at efficiency quotients, which take into account not only the stone-free rate, but also the retreatment and auxiliary procedure rate, we find that for PCNL, the efficiency quotient is high, 80% or greater, regardless of stone size. Whereas if we look at shockwave lithotripsy, we see that the efficiency quotient exceeds 50% and barely, only for stones less than a centimeter in size. And then for stones greater than one centimeter, the efficiency quotients are less than 20%, which means that not only stone-free rates are poor, but retreatment rates and auxiliary procedure rates are high. So this is just a good way of assessing the overall outcomes of the procedure. And generally, we tend to think that efficiency quotients should be greater than 50% to consider a treatment option reasonable. So once again, the conclusion would be that stones less than a centimeter might be reasonably treated with shockwave lithotripsy, even though PCNL stone-free rates are higher. It's hard to justify PCNL for stones that are less than a centimeter in size when shockwave lithotripsy rates are reasonable. But for stones greater than a centimeter in size, PCNL was so far superior and shockwave lithotripsy so inferior that it was hard to justify as well. Well, Sampeo and Arrigaro were really the first to try to investigate or evaluate some of the factors about the anatomy of the lower pole that made clearance of fragments with shockwave lithotripsy so poor. And they performed a really elegant study using endocasts of kidney collecting systems and then evaluated different anatomic features, including the infundibulopelvic angle, the infundibular width, and then the spatial anatomy of the lower pole calyces, whether the lower pole calyces were fused or whether they were all very separate. And then they actually looked at that to see whether or not it had any impact on stone-free rates with shockwave lithotripsy. Now, that study was carried a little further into the clinical realm by Ralph Klayman's group, who performed a retrospective study of patients with stones 15 millimeters or less in the lower pole who were treated with shockwave lithotripsy. And they looked at the anatomic features, again, of infundibulopelvic angle, of infundibular length, and then of infundibular width. So they didn't look at the spatial configuration of the lower pole calyces, but instead looked at infundibular length and found that favorable anatomic factors included an infundibulopelvic angle of greater than 90 degrees, an infundibular length of less than 3 centimeters, and an infundibular width of greater than 5 millimeters. And then they looked at their outcomes retrospectively with shockwave lithotripsy. And they found that if the infundibulopelvic angle was greater than 90 degrees and the infundibular length and width were favorable, they had 100% success rate with shockwave lithotripsy. When the infundibulopelvic angle was less than 40 degrees and the infundibular length and width were unfavorable, there was only a 16% success rate. If they looked at patients who had an infundibulopelvic angle greater than 70 degrees, really irrespective of what the infundibular length and width were, reasonable stone-free rates were achieved, anywhere from 67 to 91%, so that just the angle being greater than 70 degrees was a favorable enough factor. But if you looked at patients with an infundibulopelvic angle less than 70, only those who had favorable infundibular length and width factors had reasonable stone-free rates, 84%, and otherwise the stone-free rates were less than 60%. So they concluded that if the infundibulopelvic angle was greater than 70 degrees, regardless of the other factors, shockwave lithotripsy was reasonable, again, for stones between 1 and 2 centimeters in size. And if the infundibular pelvic angle was less than 40 degrees, PCNL was recommended. And then for those patients with the infundibulopelvic angle between 40 and 70 degrees, if the other anatomic factors were favorable, shockwave lithotripsy was recommended, but if the other factors, either one or both, were negative, then PCNL was recommended. So this was really one of the first times that they offered sort of an algorithm to look at patients with lower pole stones to maybe help stratify our treatment recommendations based on the anatomy of the kidney. Well, since that study, numerous other groups have looked at the impact of various anatomic factors in calyceal anatomy to see the impact on outcomes with shockwave lithotripsy, and the results have been variable. Gupta's group found that lower pole infundibular pelvic angle and infundibular width both significantly impacted stone clearance after shockwave lithotripsy. Frank Keeley's group found that only lower pole infundibular pelvic angle was the only anatomic factor that influenced stone-free rates. Tomino and their group found that the only independent predictors of stone-free rates were the infundibular length to diameter ratio, diameter, and the number of calyces. And then Symes, in a recent study, found that pelvic calyceal height significantly impacted stone-free rates. And lastly, Ganame, in another recent study, found that lower pole infundibular pelvic angle as well as infundibular length were both factors that significantly impacted stone-free rates. And then a few other groups, Madbuli and Chantok's group, both found that lower pole anatomy had no effect on stone-free rates and that only stone size was the significant factor that influenced stone-free rates. So there's been a lot of controversy in the literature, not only regarding whether or not anatomic factors influence the stone-free state, but what those factors are, and more particularly what particular cutoffs of size and length and so forth have an influence on stone-free rates. Well, there's a group, Null, that published a study in 2003 where they looked at 40 renal units on IVP and had them analyzed by five different radiology observers. They measured all these various anatomic factors three times on different days. And then they compared both the inter-observer and intra-observer variability and found that the inter-observer correspondence was really quite poor, whereas intra-observer variability was much better. So within any one individual, they were fairly consistent from measurement to measurement, but when you looked at one observer to the other, there was a lot of inconsistency in their measurements. And that might help explain what some of these differences are. Obviously, these anatomic factors are not that simple to measure. And as you can imagine, on an IVP, there are different phases of an IVP, and sometimes the kidney might be more dilated and less dilated. It might have an impact on what the measurements, for instance, of infundibular width or infundibular length might be. So this may explain some of the variability. But I think overall, there's probably at least reasonably good evidence that there is some impact of lower pole anatomy on the outcomes of stone-free rates, and our job is to determine what those factors are. Well, Palakis and colleagues published a study in 2003 where they actually constructed an artificial neural network for predicting outcomes for lower pole stones, and they had a series of 680 patients with lower pole stones who were treated with shockwave lithotripsy, in whom an overall stone-free rate of 68% was achieved. And then they assessed the impact of a variety of different factors, stone and anatomic characteristics, on stone-free rate. And they used 101 of the cases to construct the neural network for training, and then they used 600 cases to actually test the sensitivity or test the accuracy of the neural network in predicting outcomes. And then they looked at the relative importance of each of the variables that they looked at. Well, using univariate analysis, they found the body mass index, that urine transport type, and that is watching fluoroscopically, they characterize different types of transport type, the way the collecting system, peristalsed and seem to drain urine from the kidney. Infundibular diameter, infundibular pelvic angle, and infundibular ureteropelvic angle, which is a slightly different measurement, those were the factors that they found were most important on univariate analysis. Then they looked at their artificial neural network assigned relative values and found that the most important factors in order of importance were this type of urinary transport, the infundibulo-ureteropelvic angle, the calyceal pelvic height, the body mass index, and then finally stone size. So they found that when they tested on their 600 cases, when they tested the accuracy of the artificial neural network, they found a 92% accuracy in predicting lower pole stone fragment clearance. And they determined that the dynamic urinary transport was the most important factor in predicting stone clearance. they found in their study that the anatomic measurements were highly reproducible, and they actually had very low intra and inter-observer variability. But clearly there's a need for a prospective trial to determine whether or not this artificial neural network can help us predict outcomes, because it would certainly be easy to be able to make a certain, to predict a certain number of measurements, plug it into the artificial neural network, and then have some kind of number that we could present to patients to predict their outcome. So I think our challenge now really is to predict the likelihood of success for any individual patient with known anatomic factors, and these need to be factors that are relatively easily measured. And part of the problem, since we so rarely obtain IVPs anymore, it's sometimes hard to actually determine these factors from a CT, and it may require at least a CT urogram to do that. We clearly need a larger database, and we'll have to use multivariate analysis to try to construct some kind of tables that will relate stone-free rates to some kind of easily measurable anatomic factors. So hopefully there will be more word in the future and data that we can use to actually present to our patients so that maybe we can find a subgroup of patients with lower pulse stones who might be reasonably treated with shockwave lithotripsy with a reasonable expectation that they'll have a high stone-free rate. Well, ureteroscopy has now been added into the mix since all of this was going on in the 90s, I guess. And you know, the advantage of ureteroscopy is we can perform ureteroscopy on an outpatient basis. It's highly effective, it's minimally morbid, and it really works well for small stones and for Eswell failures, and it can often avoid the morbidity of a percutaneous approach. And now, as we've had such significant advances both in the technology and the technique of ureteroscopy, we have to include ureteroscopy now into our algorithm of treatment for lower pulse stones. Well, Mike Grasso and Bagley probably have the largest ureteroscopic series, and they looked at their outcomes at their two institutions for 100 ureteroscopic procedures using small caliber flexible ureteroscopes. And they found that in 93% of cases, they were able to access all locations in the kidney. But in 7% of cases, they were unable to access every location in the kidney. And in all of those cases, the place that they couldn't access was the lower pole of the kidney. And we all know that the lower pole of the kidney is the most challenging place to get to with a flexible ureteroscope. And they had to use secondary deflection to access the lower pole in about 57% of cases. So if we look at our older ureteroscopes, most of them had two-way deflection with active and passive deflection, and that allowed us to access the vast majority of places in the collecting system, even including the lower pole. Now, for small non-dilated collecting systems, it's fairly simple. If it has a relatively shallow infundibulopelvic angle, you simply pass the ureteroscope up into the kidney, and you deflect actively into the lower pole, and you can access the lower pole generally in most cases. The problem comes when you have a very dilated collecting system that has a very sharp infundibulopelvic angle, and in that case, it requires, with these older ureteroscopes, the use of both active and passive deflection. So in this case, you pass the ureteroscope into the kidney and you actively deflect the ureteroscope toward the lower pole. But you can see that the length of the active deflection doesn't even begin, in this case, to get the tip of the ureteroscope into the lower pole calyx. However, if you continue to advance the ureteroscope while actively deflecting toward the lower pole, you'll reach a point, and you can actually see kind of a density on the scope there. You reach a point on the scope of inherent weakness. And at that point, if you bank that point of the ureteroscope off the superior aspect of the renal pelvis and continue to advance the ureteroscope while undeflecting the tip, you can then advance the ureteroscope and advance or extend the tip into the lower pole calyx. And this is a fluoroscopic maneuver. It's not done under vision. You just get confused if you look. But if you do it under fluoroscopic vision, you can see how much longer you can extend that point of deflection into the lower pole calyx. So for dilated calyces, or those with a very steep infundibulopelvic angle, it's this maneuver that you have to use to get into the lower pole calyces. Well, Clayman's group tried to find other ways that we can facilitate our access to the lower pole using a ureteroscope, and they took a series of patients who were undergoing intravenous pyelograms and then had several additional views obtained with patients in different positions, both head up, head down, prone, supine, at different angles. And then they measured the angle into the lower pole calyx and found that the broadest angle of entry into the lower pole was when the patient was positioned in the prone position, 20 degrees head down. And in that case, the angle, the infundibulopelvic angle on the right side increased by 16 degrees, and on the left side by 25 degrees. So they advocated treating patients who you had a suspicion that it may be difficult to access the lower pole by treating them in the prone head down position. And they looked at a series of 24 patients who underwent prone ureteroscopy for lower pole stones, and they were able to achieve a stone-free rate of 88%. So, and the advantage of this kind of approach is that if you treat the patients prone and you can't access the lower pole, you can just move right on to a PERC. And I do that frequently. I schedule patients as ureteroscopy possible PERCs. I treat them in the prone position on spreader bars, as you can see, so that you can access both the flank and you can access them cystoscopically. And then I start out ureteroscopically, and I find that if I can't access the lower pole calyces adequately, then I just go right ahead and move on to a PERC. And that way the patients are treated one way or another. They know that when they wake up from this anesthetic that they're going to have their stone treated one way or another. Well, there's now a new generation of ureteroscopes that has really eliminated a lot of the difficulty in accessing the lower pole and has eliminated this need for fluoroscopic maneuvers and secondary deflection. And these ureteroscopes have dual active primary and or secondary deflection. The first of these was the ACMI DUR Elite, which has active primary and active secondary deflection controlled by two different levers. So you can see the kind of deflection that you can get with this ureteroscope that allows you to get into a very steep lower pole calyx, or one that in a very dilated collecting system. And then the Storz Flex X is a second version of a ureteroscope. In this case, it has just active secondary deflection. There is no active primary deflection, but by using secondary deflection and placing the ureteroscope in a calyx, you essentially get primary deflection just because of the shape of the calyx. And this is controlled by one lever. So with these new ureteroscopes, we can almost always access the lower pole calyces, and it doesn't require any special maneuvers to do so. Well, the problem is it's not enough to just get the scope into the lower pole calyx. I think we've all been in the situation where we're there and we see the stone, and then the minute we pass our laser or working instrument through the ureteroscope, it undeflects our scope and we no longer can access the pathology. So we know that it takes anywhere from about 104 to 175 degrees of deflection to access the lower pole calyces. But when you pass an instrument through the ureteroscope, you can lose up to 86 degrees of deflection, which can be more than enough to eliminate your ability to access the lower pole calyces. So there are a number of maneuvers that you can do to help improve the deflection of the scope. One is to keep the shaft of the scope as straight as possible. An access sheath can help that because it'll keep the scope from buckling in the bladder, but you should never do that through actually a cystoscope sheath because you're likely to shear or damage the ureteroscope. But an access sheath keeps the shaft of the scope straight, which will enhance the ability to deflect the tip. If you put just a little bit of back tension on the scope, just sort of pulling back on the handle while stretching a little bit forward with your opposite hand, you also can enhance the deflection at the tip. And then if you place a super stiff wire through the ureteroscope, not all the way through, but just enough to stiffen the shaft, again, it gives you a little additional maneuverability of the scope, particularly if there's any difficulty advancing the scope, for instance, through the intramural ureter. The extra rigidity of the shaft will help you maneuver around in the kidney a little better. But lastly, it's just important to keep in mind that you should always straighten the scope to less than 30 degrees before you pass any instruments through it so that you can avoid any damage to the working channel. Now, the nitinol retrieving devices, I think, have to some degree really revolutionized our ability also to treat lower pole stones ureteroscopically, because laser fibers are relatively stiff and it's hard to get a laser fiber into the lower pole. The nitinol instruments, both the tipless nitinol baskets and then these nitinol combination grasper baskets, have the advantage that they are very flexible, and they cause minimal, if any, loss of deflection of the ureteroscope. John Honey looked at that and saw that there was less than a 10-degree loss of deflection through standard 7.5 French flexible ureteroscopes. So you can generally get to the lower pole and access it with a basket without losing so much deflection that it pushes you out of the lower pole calyx. Ray Levely's group actually looked at the degree of loss of deflection with a variety of different working channels through the ACMI DUR8 Elite ureteroscope and found that the 1.6 French EHL probe, the 2.4 and 3 French nitinol baskets, and the 200 micron holmium laser fibers all caused the least loss of deflection of the ureteroscope, particularly the nitinol devices and the EHL probe, although not many of us are using EHL anymore. But you should keep in mind that you lose almost no deflection when you use a small EHL probe. So these are the devices that are going to be most effective for use in the lower pole. But it's important to keep in mind with that particular scope that the order in which you deflect the active and the primary and the secondary deflection will impact how much deflection you get out of the tip. So if you start with primary deflection first, you'll get the maximum secondary deflection, or you'll get the maximum secondary deflection if you start with primary deflection and then go to secondary deflection rather than the reverse. If you start with your secondary deflection and then use your primary deflection, you don't get quite as much deflection. So it's important to keep that in mind when you're trying to access the lower pole. Well, Glenn Preminger was really the first to sort of put it together that perhaps because it's so difficult to access the lower pole, and when using a 200 micron laser fiber, you often can get there, but again, the laser fiber causes some loss of deflection of the ureteroscope, that perhaps if we displaced stones from the lower pole of the kidney to a more accessible mid or upper pole calyx, that we could then treat the stones more readily. And because the nitinol devices are so flexible and cause so little loss of deflection, we can generally get the ureteroscope into the lower pole, we can engage them in a basket, displace the stone, and then we can easily treat it with our laser fiber. So he was the first to suggest displacing the stones from the lower pole to a mid or upper pole, and then easily treating the stone with a laser fiber in the more accessible upper pole location. And they looked at a series of patients who they were treating for lower pole stones ureteroscopically, and there were 10 patients in whom they were able to see the stone in the lower pole with the ureteroscope, but they couldn't get on it once they put the laser fiber through the ureteroscope. So they took those patients and displaced those stones with either a nitinol grasper or basket, displaced them into the upper pole calyx, and then fragmented there, and found that they had a 90% success rate or stone-free rate for the patients with displaced stones versus an 83% for stones that were treated in situ. Now, Stewart-Wolf also looked at their series of patients with lower pole stones in whom 59 of the patients were treated in situ and 19 of the patients underwent displacement of the stone out of the lower pole. So overall, there was a higher stone-free rate with the displaced stones, 94% versus 71%, although that difference didn't quite reach statistical significance. But when he stratified those results by stone size, you see that there was really no impact of in situ versus displaced treatment for stones that were less than a centimeter in size. But for stones greater than a centimeter in size, there was a marked difference in stone-free rates, 100% success rate for the displaced stones in that stone size versus only 29% stone-free rate for in situ treated stones. So perhaps, particularly for larger stones, we would do better to move those stones out of the lower pole and fragment them in another location. Gerhard Fuchs then took that concept a little further and reported, I don't think he's published this yet, this was presented at the AUA a couple years ago, where he did the same thing, displaced stones from a lower pole calyx to an upper pole calyx, but then injected autologous blood through the ureteroscope into the lower pole infundibulum to fill the infundibulum and calyx, and then subsequently fragmented the stones in the upper pole calyx with the idea that the lower pole calyx and infundibulum would be occluded by clot, and therefore the stone fragments would be less likely to accumulate back in the lower pole calyx, and it would be encouraged to travel down the ureter, and you could potentially improve stone-free rates. So it's an interesting concept. I mean, in practice it's difficult because oftentimes the clot gets all over the place, but it is an interesting idea for preventing the reaccumulation of fragments in the lower pole. Well, with that all being said, and the success that we potentially have with the ureteroscopic management of lower pole stones, we initiated a second phase of the lower pole study in which we incorporated ureteroscopy now into this algorithm that includes shockwave lithotripsy and PCNL. And in this study, 109 patients were enrolled, and they were divided into two groups. Group 1 consisted of patients with stones a centimeter or less in size, and group 2 included patients with stones between 1 and 2.5 centimeters in size. And then both groups were randomized. Group 1 was randomized to shockwave lithotripsy or ureteroscopy because we had already determined from the previous lower pole study that shockwave lithotripsy was a reasonable option for stones in this size category. And then group two randomized patients to ureteroscopy or PCNL because we had already determined that shockwave lithotripsy was not reasonable for stones greater than a centimeter in size. Now, in this case, the primary outcome parameter was stone-free rate using CT criteria. So remember, the last lower pole study used nephrotomograms for their primary outcome parameter. So once again, just as nephrotomograms resulted in lower stone-free rates compared to retrospective series using KUB, we would probably expect that stone-free rates will be somewhat lower using CT rather than nephrotomograms because of the greater sensitivity of CT in detecting residual fragments. So if we look first at group one and compare the outcomes from shockwave lithotripsy and ureteroscopy, we see that operative time, not surprisingly, is shorter for shockwave lithotripsy by about 24 minutes. Stone-free rates, surprisingly, were disappointingly low in both groups, only 35% for shockwave lithotripsy and 52% for ureteroscopy. Again, keep in mind CT criteria. So even though there was a 17% difference in stone-free rates favoring ureteroscopy, that difference didn't reach statistical significance. And I think that was probably the most disappointing finding of all in this trial. Secondary procedures were not significantly different between the two groups, although they were three times higher for shockwave lithotripsy. Intraoperative and postoperative complications, again, no significant difference between groups. Length of stay was short, outpatient procedure in most cases in both groups. And then overall convalescence time was significantly shorter for shockwave lithotripsy than ureteroscopy by about a week, and I suspect that that probably reflects, you know, having a stent in for a week. If we then look at group two, the patients with stones between 1 and 2.5 centimeters, one of the interesting outcomes, I think, is that operative time was not significantly different between ureteroscopy and PCNL. And I think that reflects the fact that these are pretty easy PCNLs, often pluck and runs, whereas ureteroscopic procedures, these are long, tedious procedures when you're dealing with stones greater than a centimeter in size. So there was no difference in the overall operative time. Stone-free rate was significantly higher for PCNL compared to ureteroscopy. And again, look at the only 37% stone-free rate for ureteroscopy. Secondary procedure rates, intraoperative complications, and postoperative complications were not significantly different between the two groups. And overall length of stay, not surprisingly, shorter for ureteroscopy compared to PCNL. But an interesting statistic was that the overall convalescence time was not significantly different between the two groups, probably reflecting the fact that these are pretty easy PCNLs. Patients get out of the hospital quickly, not a lot of manipulation in the kidney versus long ureteroscopic cases and the need for a stent postoperatively. So I think if we combine the outcomes then from lower pole studies 1 and 2, we find that for stones less than a centimeter, shockwave both have poor stone-free rates, although secondary outcome parameters and patient acceptance tends to favor shockwave lithotripsy. And because there's not a significant difference in stone-free rates between the two, it's hard to argue against shockwave lithotripsy despite fairly dismal stone-free rates. Again, it's still hard to justify and hard to expect that people will still resort to PCNL for small stones. For stones greater than 2 centimeters in size, PCNL is clearly superior. And then for stones between 1 and 2 centimeters, ureteroscopy was associated with poor stone-free rates, and PCNL overall had the best outcomes. Although I think we need to look at things in the future like the use of ureteral access sheaths, the use of manual retrieval of stone fragments, displacing stones from the lower pole to the upper pole, and perhaps we can find a subgroup of patients who will be more successfully treated ureteroscopically. Well, knowing some of the data that we have, now this is a study I'm going to talk about that was done in 2003 where we didn't have the results of the second lower pole study group, but Glenn Gerber did an interesting internet and postal survey of American urologists querying them about their management of lower pole stones in the various size categories. There are 205 respondents. And what he found is that for stones less than a centimeter, the vast majority of urologists chose shockwave lithotripsy as their first treatment, and that's probably reasonable based on the data that we now know. For stones between 1 and 2 centimeters, however, nearly two-thirds of patients chose shockwave lithotripsy, despite the fact that we know that stone-free rates are probably in the order of 20% at best, and only 30% of respondents actually chose PCNL. And then for stones greater than 2 centimeters in size, more than 3/4 of urologists chose PCNL as their first treatment, which is appropriate. But still, fully 21% of urologists would perform shockwave lithotripsy, despite stone-free rates of about 14% from the first lower pole stone study. So I think hopefully if we were to redo that survey now, we would find perhaps that there's just been a lag in practice patterns before many urologists have recognized some of the limitations of these outcomes, and that they'll more reflect some of the data that I've presented. So for an algorithm for lower pole stones, I think we look at the size of the stones, and for stones less than 10 millimeters in size, I think shockwave lithotripsy or ureteroscopy are reasonable, although I think it's important that we tell patients that relatively low stone-free rates are achieved with those treatments. And that, again, using CT criteria, there's probably an expectation there is going to be some small fragments left over. And I think that what it really reflects is that any treatment modalities that rely on spontaneous passage of stone fragments are going to be limited and are going to be inferior to those in which fragments are literally removed, as they are in PCNL. I think the group of stones between 10 and 20 millimeters are the problem. And I think we have to look at things like favorable anatomic factors that might select subgroups of patients who can be successfully treated with ESWOL. And I think we have to look at particular maneuvers ureteroscopically, like the use of a ureteral access sheath, displacement of fragments, and manual retrievement of fragments that might enhance stone-free rates with ureteroscopy. And if any of those factors prove to be favorable, then maybe any of the treatment modalities are reasonable in select cases. But if favorable anatomic factors aren't present, and if we don't take any specific measures to enhance the stone-free rates after ureteroscopy, then PCNL should be the treatment of choice in that size category. And then for stones greater than 2 centimeters in size, I think clearly PCNL is the treatment of choice, and that we're probably fooling ourselves to think that we can do anything successful either ureteroscopically or with shockwave lithotripsy for stones in that size category. Thank you very much.